So, just a brief recap of the previous class, and we talked about the various amino acids, 20 different amino acids, and what are the chemical shift ranges of the different protons in the different amino acids. These are indicated in this plots here. For the different amino acids, you have different ranges of chemical shifts for the different types of protons. So, we also talked about the different proton types, their nomenclature, as was discussed in the previous class. And these ones show up in different kinds of two dimensional spectra. A typical one is shown here. This is the chemical shift ranges in folded proteins of the toxi spectrum. So, here only one particular region is shown here. So, the amide protons to the various alpha protons and the beta protons and things like that, and also the side chains here. So, and a whole Cauchy spectrum is shown like this here. So, it shows this is the area of the amide protons and the aromatic protons, and you have the correlations in the Cauchy spectrum to the alpha protons here, and then you also have from the aromatic protons to its own beta protons and so on. Then of course, when you go here, then you will have the correlation from the alpha protons to the beta protons, and then from the beta to the gamma, gamma to the delta and things like that. So, that is how the connectivities of the various protons are established in the Cauchy spectrum. The same thing will be available in the double quantum filtered Cauchy, and the Toxi goes a little bit further, and it establishes a relay of information in the spin system. So, here a comparison of the Cauchy spectrum here, a particular segment which is showing you the 5 peaks here, and these 5 peaks actually are also present here in the Toxi spectrum, but it shows a relay to other protons, and that is indicated by the different peaks which are present at the same chemical shift here. For example, for this particular peak here, there are others which are present here, which shows the correlation to the other protons which are connected to this proton through a network of coupled spins. Similarly, for this one you also have a correlation here. So, like that, for every proton there is a relay that happens in the Toxi spectrum that establishes the spin system network. And this is another region of a particular spectrum. You have the Cauchy here, and this is the Toxi spectrum here, and you can see a full network of correlations in the Toxi spectrum. Only near neighbor interactions, the 3 bond couples or the 2 bond coupled ones are shown in the, are seen in the Cauchy spectrum. In the Toxi spectrum, you have a whole range of connectivities from the alpha to the beta, and then alpha to the gamma, alpha to the delta, and so on and so forth, that will appear because of the relay that happens in the Toxi spectrum. This is what we have seen earlier when we discussed about the methods. Okay. So, now we come to the next step, that is the information in the J correlated spectra. So, what do we use? Ultimately, our objective is to obtain the so called sequence specific proton resonance assignment in proteins. You will have to be able to assign the individual protons to individual residues. Okay, there are different types of residues which we discussed there. So, we have to establish the networks of J couplings in the individual residues. This comes from the Cauchy, double quantum filtered Cauchy, or the Toxi spectra. This is known as the spin system identification. What is the meaning of the spin system? So, let me also just briefly give you a recap of that one. So, if you have a 3 spin system, you may have a system like this. You may solve this is the AMX, or if you have a linear system AMX Q and so on so forth, these are called as the spin systems. There are couplings at each stage. There is a coupling here and a coupling there, and here there will be coupling there, there is a coupling there, and there is a coupling there. So, all of them are in that way connected. So, therefore, this is known as the spin system. What type of a spin system is present in your spectra? So, if you have a protein chain which consists of various amino acid residues, for example, if I want to write an amino acid chain as A, T, G, C, L, Q and so on so forth, each one of them has a particular type of spin system connectivities, and that is called as the spin system identification, and this is known from the Cauchy and double quantum filtered Cauchy. So, many of these amino acid residues may belong to the similar type of a spin system. That is why we need to classify these amino acid residues as AMX system or a long side chain. So, you have the classification of the residue types, AMX type, or that means it will be something like this here, or the long side chain, it may be something like this here, or the glycine which it does not go too far, or there are some residues which contain the methyls. These are typically the leucines, isoleucine, alanines and threonines, valine. These ones are the methyl bearing residues. They produce characteristic patterns in the COSY and the TOXY spectra. So therefore, from the COSY and the TOXY spectra, what we do is, at a particular chemical shift, what type of a spin system is present, whether it is an AMX system or is an AMXQ type of a system or AMXQR kind of a spin system, how many protons are connected to in the network. So that is what we establish in this. The long side chain means there are many protons which are connected in the network. Glycine has only 2 protons and the methyl bearing residues also may have a long side chains. All of these can come inside this network of spin systems and we classify the amino acid residues in that. Then after we have done that, we put the the polypeptide chain, and we do not read it like a polypeptide chain in this, we will read it as a spin system sequence. Okay, there is a 3 spin system, long side chain sequence, glycine, and then of course again this long side chain, again a small spin system, and so on and so forth. So you will categorize them on the basis of the spin systems. Therefore, he said the writing the protein sequence in terms of the classes. There will be several classes as we indicated here. These are the types of the amino acid residues. Immediately we do not know which residue is where. Okay, so you may have several glycines in your polypeptide chain, several phenylalanines, there will be several tyrosines, all of them belong to a particular type of a residue or the spin system. Therefore, all of them belong to the same, whether you have glycine, whether you have a tyrosine or a phenylalanine, they both belong to the same type of spin system. Or you have the threonine, it is a different spin system, alanine is a different spin system. Okay, and likewise the long side chain ones, suppose you have the arginine or the lysines or the glutamate or the glutamine, these ones have long side chains, so they will classify them as long side chains. That is what you will write, you will write the protein sequence in terms of the classes. Okay, that is the first step. This information is obtainable from the COSY, DQ of COSY and TOXY spectra, because these display the J correlations, the J coupling correlations. Notice here of course that we only have these things from the within the same amino acid residues. These ones do not connect one residue to the next residue on either side. Therefore, this is within the same amino acid residue, what sort of spin systems are present and what are the correlations established. So from the COSY spectrum, you identify that, okay, now if I go back here, so I will say if I am looking at this, this may be an AMX spin system, this is an AM glycine spin system, or this is a glycine spin system, or this may be again an AMX spin system, and like that. So I will say on the basis at the particular chemical shift, I will put this as a as an AMX spin system, or a long side chain spin system, or the methyl bearing residue spin system, etc. So this is how you obtain this information from the TOXY spectra. So this is the COSY, and you compare that with the TOXY here, you get the connectivities, and on the basis of that you say, okay, now here it is a system which has a long side chain. There are many cross peaks originating from this particular diagonal peak here. You have a peak here, a peak there, and a peak there, and a peak there. So therefore, many correlations are present. That means that particular spin system is a long side chain once. So it has the alphas, and the betas, and the gammas, and the deltas, and so on and so forth. So you first classify your polypeptide chain along these lines. Okay, here it is a long side chain, the long side chain, short side chain, methyl bearing, AMX spin system, and so forth. So that is what is called as writing the protein sequence in terms of the classes. Next, we have to connect these spin systems sequentially. So we have these neighboring residues, near neighbor connections. The near neighbor connections, these do not come from the COSY spectra or the TOXY spectra. There are no J couplings there, and there are also no relays. Okay. So therefore, this information will not be obtainable from the J correlated spectra. So we have to resort here to the NOSY spectra. The NOSY spectrum displays distance correlations, and there are short distances between the near neighbors, and there can be short range connections over a longer distance, in the sense that, okay, 3 residues, 4 residues apart, or there can also be long range connections which are because of the folding of the protein, there may be things which are coming which are 10 residues, 15 residues, 20 residues apart, and you may have that sort of a connections also because the protons come close by in space, and that is what the NOSY spectrum displays. The NOSY spectrum displays those proton-proton correlations which have short distances. less than 5 angstroms. So, therefore, we have to distinguish all the 3 different types of connections here. First thing is to use the near neighbor connections to identify the sequential connectivities. So, individually you walk from one polypeptide chain, one residue to the next residue along the polypeptide chain. So, these are the 2 steps which are there, and then once you do that you obtain the sequence specific resonance assignments in proteins. Okay. Now, what sort of, how do this spectra look like for the different amino acid residues? This obviously depends upon the chemical shift ranges. Now, here again I have put in the various amino acid structures there, and the corresponding type of correlation you will see in the COSY or the TOXY spectrum. For example, for the histidine ring, so where is the histidine here? So, we have the histidine aromatic residues. The let us look at where is histidine here, arginine, ok, the histidine is here, ok. So, now you see this has 2 protons, there is a proton here and there is a proton there. There can be correlation between the amide proton to this proton, and there can be correlation, sometimes you will have correlation from this proton to this proton correlations, you will see that sort of a system. So, you will have the 2H and the 4H. Which are the 2H, 4H? This is the 2H, this is the 4H. If you are recording the spectra in D2O, so when you are recording the spectra in D2O, the amide protons do not show up, okay, or the immunoprotons or the NH protons do not show up, because they all exchange with water, exchange with the D2O, and they will not be present. So, these spectra are recorded in D2O. So, when we do that, then of course, you will see the correlation from this proton, both these protons are attached to the carbon, C2H and C4H, those are these 2 positions, okay, and you will see a correlation between them. So, this will become like an AX spin system. Similarly, the tyrosine ring, let us look at the tyrosine. The tyrosine is among the aromatic residues, right, the aromatic residues, phenylalanine, and we have, this is phenylalanine and threonine. Let us look at where is the tyrosine, okay, now here is tyrosine, okay, this is Y. Now, how many protons are there? So, this OH of course is not visible, there are 4 protons there. Typically, these 2 may be, these 2 will be equivalent and these 2 may be equivalent, but they may need not be also. So, if they are not equivalent, then you write it as AA prime XX prime, but if they are equivalent, so what are those positions? This position and this position. If they are equivalent, then they will say this is an A2, and this, if they are equivalent, they need to say X2. So, it can be an A2 X2 spin system, or if they are non-equivalent, then they may be AA prime XX prime spin system. And the non-equivalence can arise in the protein structure where there is a free rotation is restricted, and therefore, they may see different environments and their chemical shifts can be different. So, therefore, if we have, what is drawn here is when the 2 are equivalent, their chemical shifts are the same, but they, their coupling constant may be different. So, though you may write in general as AA prime XS prime to be more general, so but the chemical shifts of these 2 are the same, therefore, they are typically represented as one chemical shift here and another chemical shift there, because you have used the same symbol A. Okay. So, the chemical shifts are the same, but the coupling constants may not be the same. That is why you say make them as magnetically non-equivalent, but chemically equivalent. When you have that, of course, there is only one coupling. So, the coupling is from this proton to this proton, and that is this cross pair. You will have from the, in the aromatic ring, you will only have this, but of course, in the backbone, you will have the beta protons also. The beta protons will show the alpha to the alpha to the beta 1 and beta 2. What is shown here is only the ring protons, what, how are they connected in the ring, okay, these are special, these are aromatic protons, these are special, they have the ring, and therefore, what is shown here is the connectivity in the ring. Now, if you go to the phenylalanine, that is phenylalanine is here, now this has 5 protons there. Once again, there can be equivalence here, equivalence there, but the third one will not be equivalent. So, therefore, you have here 2, 6, 3, 5 and 4. So, the 4 is this central fellow here, and the other ones are 2, 6 and 3, 5, and you will see correlations, you will see from 3, 5 to 2, 6. So, here this is 3, 5 to 2, 6, you will see this cross peak, okay, 3, 5 to 2, 6, this cross peak is the prominent one. And this 3, 5, those ones are here, these are the 3, 5, and those ones show to the 4, therefore, you see that cross peak also here. You do not see 2, 6 to 4, 2, 6 are these, and you may not see the cross peak here to the 4. So therefore, you do not see the 2, 6 to 4, but you will see from 3, 5 to 4 and 3, 5 to 6. You have, what is shown here is on only one side of the diagonal, but these peaks will also be present on the other side. See, this 2, 6 to 4, it can be a very weak one. This may not be present, but it may be seen in the Toxi spectra. These may not be seen in the Cosi spectra, this peak, but they may be seen in the Toxi spectra. Therefore, this spin system becomes AA prime, XX prime and M. And that is the one of the single fellow, which is the 5, and that will be this the 4, this will be this M, and these 2 are the AA prime, XS prime, these are the 3, 5 and 2, 6, and this one is your M. And similarly, if you go to the tryptophan ring, the tryptophan ring is this one here, and you have the correlations of these protons there. Big empty circles are the ones which are seen in the Cosi. So you will see from 5 to 6. And then you will see from 5 to 4, then you will see from 1 to 6, and that is the nomenclature which, if you remember, that is represented them as the various alpha, beta, gamma, etc. But within the ring, the nomenclature goes by the numbers in this one. So you will see this sort of a pattern for the tryptophan. You will see these 3 peaks in the Cosi spectrum, but in the Toxi spectrum, you may see this intermediate peaks as well. You may see this peak, you may see this peak, and those ones will be present in the case of tryptophan. Okay. This 2 proton, this one actually stands alone, and this does not have any coupling to anybody. So that is a single peak, which is which will not be seen. Okay. That is you will have this one here, this proton there on the side, and that does not have any coupling to any other proton. Therefore, you will not see any correlation from this proton to any other proton, and all others are in the 6 membered ring, and you will see correlations between the protons in the 6 membered ring. Okay. Now if we go further to the other side chains, so you have here valines, the side chains are indicated here, already indicated here. So you have this, so gamma, gamma 1, gamma 2, so this is the valine. Valine has this, there is a methyl here. Okay. So you will see this sort of a pattern, beta to the 2 gamma. So it is coming from the alpha. The alpha proton is here on the side, alpha is not shown, only the side chain beyond the alpha proton is shown. You have one beta proton, to that are attached 2 methyls, gamma 1 and gamma 2, and these are the 2, these are the 2 methyls. This is NHT alpha COOH, and this is the C alpha, and this is the C beta, and that C beta, there is one proton there, and it is connected to the 2 methyls there. Okay, so that is shown here. So you have the beta proton there. Okay, and these are the gamma 1 and gamma 2, and this is the alpha proton. Okay, now from the alpha proton, you are seeing to the beta proton, that is this, the alpha proton is here under the C alpha, which is present there. To the beta proton, you see this peak here, and from the beta proton, you see to the 2 methyls, from this beta to these 2, this and this correlation. You will see from beta proton to the 2 methyls here. Okay, and you do not see between the 2 gamma methyls, because there is no coupling there. Therefore, you will not see that cross peak. Leucine, if you see, again it has the alpha to the beta, and then beta, there are 2 beta protons, you see to the both the beta protons, alpha to the beta 1 and beta 2, these are the 2 betas, and then from the betas you see to the gamma, there is one gamma proton there. So from the gamma you see, so both the beta protons show to the gamma, and from the gamma you see to the 2 methyls, there are 2 methyls on the one is called as a delta, the 2 delta methyls. Some gamma proton you see to the 2 methyls, you see to these peaks there. And of course, if you are looking at the Toxi, the dashed lines and dotted lines indicate that these, you may see these additional peaks when you go to the Toxi spectra. In the Cosi you will see only these, or in the double quantum filtered Cosi you will see only these empty circles which are indicated there. So you will see these cross peaks, and if you go to the Toxi you might see these individual correlations as well. So similarly, isoleucine has this network of couplings there. You have the from the alpha proton to the beta proton, from the beta to, you see to the gamma 1 and gamma 2, there are 2 gammas there, beta to the gamma 1 and gamma 2, and these gamma protons are connected to the methyl, to the delta, and therefore you will see from the both the gamma protons you will see to the methyls. Okay. So that is how this spin system goes for these amino acid residues. And likewise for the serines and other, these are called the ABX spin systems or the AMX spin systems, because this has the side chain has only alpha to the beta and to the beta, that's all, alpha beta, there is nothing beyond the beta proton. Okay, for example, you can see here, so serine has alpha to the beta and there is nothing, and these ones will not be seen. The aspartate similarly to the beta, and you do not have any other coupling there, okay, these ones are gone. Asparagine, this alpha to the 2 beta proton, so alpha proton is there on the side when the C alpha is there, okay. And so similarly the cysteine, alpha to the 2 betas. Here the tryptophan, this alpha beta proton region is also shown. The aromatic ones also have this alpha to the beta. We talked earlier about the rings here, okay, we only talk about within the ring what is present there. Now you see including the alpha, you will see alpha to the betas, the 2 beta protons, the 2 beta protons and so on. And there is no coupling from the beta protons to the aromatic protons. Therefore, you will not see cross peak from the aromatic protons, from the beta protons to the aromatic proton. These appear separately and they have to be identified differently. Now all these are, there are these many 8 amino acid residues which we classify spin, as AMX spin systems or sometimes ABX spin systems. So because there are 3 spin systems, so wherever this serine, cysteine, aspargine is present in your polypeptide chain, you may call it as a particular type of spin system, that is called as the J spin system. J, you represent it as J, 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 wherever this is present you write it as J, okay. And the long side chain ones are represented differently, so you have this sort of a spin system. And what you have here, only alpha to the beta, beta 1 and beta 2, and then you also have a cross peak between the beta 1 and the beta 2 protons. So this is only one side of this diagonal is shown, and you have this cross peak. There is here the toxi and the cosi do not make a difference at all, because there is a beta 1 and beta 2 and there is no other relay. So there is a direct coupling here, and all of these peaks can be seen in the cosi, DQ of cosi, and toxi will be identical, okay. Now this is another type of spin system, as indicated these are the long side chains. So from the alpha you go to the beta, beta to the gamma, gamma to the delta, and then delta to the further ones, epsilon and things like that, okay. So these are long side chain ones. So how many are there? Lysine, arginine, methionine, glutamine, glutamic acid, proline. These are called as the long side chain ones, because the network goes quite long. You go from the alpha, you see to the 2 betas, 2 betas to the 2 gammas, 2 gammas to these ones there. Of course, you may not go beyond here something. These are the amino protons, and these will exchange out and you will not see. So it will be seen only up to this point. If you see lysine from the alpha to the 2 betas, 2 betas to the 2 gammas, then to the 2 deltas, and then from there you go to the 2 epsilons, and after that you do not see, because this one goes to the Ganesh group and this will be exchanged out in the D2O spectra. Arginine, it is similar, alpha to the 2 betas, beta to the 2 gammas, gammas to the 2 deltas, and after that you do not see, okay. So and therefore the lysine has one more non-exchangeable proton compared to the arginine, whereas the arginine has more exchangeable protons. These will be seen more in the H2O spectra. There also you will see one of them, that is typically here, but these ones also typically exchange out in water because of the exposure. And the methionine has alpha to the 2 betas, to B to the 2 gammas, and then of course you do not have any other thing there. There is a CH3 group there, but it has no coupling to any of these ones. This is a long the 4 bond, and you will not see a correlation between these here. And the glutamine has once again alpha to the 2 betas, beta to the 2 gammas, and then after that you do not see anything there, and because these are exchanging out with the water. And the glutamate is also similar, glutamine and glutamate are similar. And now the proline is interesting. If you see alpha to the beta, okay, there are 2 betas, 2 betas to the gammas, 2 gammas, and the gammas to the deltas here, and that's it what you have. So therefore this is a closed ring here. So and you will therefore, because of the ring closure, of course its chemical shifts are also different. And how does it look in the spectrum? And the spectrum I am showing you here, the alpha proton region is here. This is typically alpha to the 2 betas. Now you see that the betas are more of field compared to the gammas in these residues. Glutamine, glutamate, methionine, these the betas are upfield to the compared to the gammas. Why is it so? Because these gammas are attached to either a sulfur or oxygen or a nitrogen, and therefore they get downfield shifted in these 3 residues, okay, and therefore the betas are above and the gammas are below. So you see from the beta to the 2 gammas, alpha to the 2 betas, and from the both the betas you see to the 2 gammas, therefore you have 4 peaks there, and you also have the beta beta cross peak, okay. And now in proline and arginine, so you have the alpha to the 2 betas, and now this one is in the middle, the chemical shift ranges. Look at the chemical shift range, that is important to notice here, how the chemical shifts vary depending upon the structure of the side chains there. So the 2 betas are here and the gamma is above, so the betas are connected to the gamma by these 2 cross peaks, and the gamma is connected to the delta which is down here, much closer to the alpha proton here, gamma is down here. So these characteristic patterns are very interesting. Same thing happens with the arginine, and in the case of why the delta is below, because why the delta is below, because they are attached to the nitrogen. See, both in the arginine as well as in proline, the delta proton is attached to the nitrogen, and therefore this comes much downfield and is closer to the alpha proton. Therefore this pattern is very distinct from the other ones there, although they are all long side chains, but the patterns of the peaks are different there. And lysine, if you see the alpha to the 2 betas which are down here, and beta to the 2 gammas, the gammas are here, beta to the 2 gammas, these peaks there, and of course you have the gamma to the delta which is very close to this one. Often you may not be able to distinguish between these because these are too close, and then from the delta to the epsilon. Now the epsilon is distinct, epsilon comes very far away because it is attached to the nitrogen, so this comes quite downfield there. So this is how you get a very distinct pattern for these spin systems. So these are called as U spin systems, and because these ones are long side chain ones, they are called as U spin. So this is the nomenclature which was adopted in the book by Professor Wittrich, and these pictures are actually taken from the Wittrich's book. All of these are from the Wittrich's book, which is NMR of Proteins and Nucleic Acids, and that is published quite a long time ago. And he was a pioneer in doing all of these assignments and the protein structure determination, for which he of course won the Nobel Prize in 2002. Okay, or the next step. Next step is to do connections from one residue to other residue, and this will come from the Nosy spectrum. Okay, I think we will stop here when we take it to the next class.